We're often asked about details of measuring power of very low power pulsed beams. Well, to measure average power of beams down in the nanowatt and milliwatt range, we normally use photodiode-based sensors. Depending on the spectral region, it might be the silicon-based PD300 or the germanium-based PD300IR, for example. One of the characteristics of photodiode-based sensors is that they have a very fast physical response time, typically on the order of nanoseconds. The processing and calculations required to get an actual measurement might take a bit longer, but what this means is that when measuring a pulsed beam, the detector signal can generally actually keep up with the pulses. This is unlike the situation, for example, with a thermal sensor, which normally has a time constant on the order of about a second. We can see over here a pulsing source and the reading that's obtained using a thermal sensor and a photodiode-based sensor, in this case the PD300. With a thermal sensor, the pulses are physically averaged out by the sensor itself. But as we can see, the photodiode-based PD300 is actually keeping up with the pulses. Can we then use a photodiode-based sensor to measure the average power of such pulsed beams? Normally, the average power of these beams might be too low to use a thermal sensor. In general, yes, we can use photodiode-based sensors for such applications, but two physical issues do need to be kept in mind. One, if the pulse frequency is close to the typically 15 Hz sampling rate of the instrument, let's say 10 or tens of Hz, we often get a beat frequency, which means essentially that the reading is going to jump around and getting a measurement is going to be difficult. Similarly, when we're working at very low pulse repetition rates, we also can have a reading that jumps around and is difficult to properly record. The solution to this is to use the averaging function available on Ophir meters. What this does is it displays not the moment-by-moment real-time reading, but rather the running average over a time period that the user can select. Two, it's possible for a pulsed beam to have average power within the specified average power range of the sensor, and yet be made of pulses whose pulse energy is high enough to cause momentary saturation of the detector. This could result in a reading that's incorrect, and yet no overrange warning will indicate to the user that there's anything wrong because the average power is, after all, within specification. It's important then to be sure that the pulse energy, and not only the average power, is within the specified range. This parameter, maximum pulse energy, is actually included in all specifications of the PD300 family of photodiode-based sensors for just this reason.